Good morning, friends. Now in today's session, we are going to discuss about the safety aspects during handling and processing of energetic materials, or it is sometimes called as explosive chemicals, and sometimes it is called as research-oriented energetic materials. Now generally, when we have discussed or talk about the chemicals, so we have talked about the general chemicals and their safety aspects. Then we have discussed about the hazardous chemicals and their safety aspects, legal compliance, legal requirement, etc. Then we have talked about the dangerous goods. Then we have talked about the classification of chemical as per MSIHC 1989. Then some of the chemicals which is specifically designed for specific purpose. So now in this session also, we are going to discuss about a specific chemicals which are explosive category, and it is generally called as energetic material. Now when these energetic materials are used for the research purpose, generally in the defense lab, in the research lab which are covered under the central government systems, or the research lab which is designed for the purpose of different fuels like rocket propellant, or for designing or preparing some of the explosive which can be used in the defense area. So there are different purposes. So that may be the explosive purpose which is controlled by the military department or the central government department, or which can be used in the fuel for the rocket propellant, or fuel for the other purposes where energy requirement is very high. So the materials which are having the characteristics that they are having a high energy at a natural source, that materials are called as energetic materials. And these energetic materials, if it is ignited or contacted with the ignition, then the explosion can happen, and that is why it is sometimes called as explosive chemicals. We are knowing about the Bombay blast, that is bomb blast, which has happened in 1993. So where terrorists have used RDX. Then we also know the different terrorist attack where TNT is used, that is trinitrotoluene, and we are also knowing about the fuels which is used in the rockets. So aluminium and aluminium powder, their derivatives, etc., are used as a fuel composition. So these are the different examples which we commonly know as it is a negative side from these explosive chemicals. But there are different good purposes also where we can use these explosive or energetic materials. And that is why while handling these energetic materials in the research area, in the research and development department of any type of industry, or in the military area, in the defense area, or the different authentic laboratories which is governed by the central government or the defense departments. So while handling these energetic materials, while storing this energetic material, while processing this energetic material, or while developing some chemicals, some composites with the help of this energetic material, we must take care of these handling processes or storing processes or processing purposes. So some of the SOPs are already designed by the government, and some of the general safety aspects that I have included in this presentation. So let us discuss what exactly the materials are, what are their characteristics, and how to handle, store, or process this energetic material in a safety way. So in the first slide itself, you can observe the NFPA diamond. So everyone know that NFPA coding or NFPA rating. So this diamond clearly indicates that this red color or red symbol is nothing but the flammability hazard. Then the blue symbol or blue color is mentioning the about health hazard. Then yellow indicating about the instability hazard, or sometime it is called as reactivity hazard, and white color indicates the special hazards. So normally this color with number is there always in the NFPA rating in the diamond, and this number is ranging from 0 to 4. So 0 is generally no hazard or very less hazard, and 4 is highly hazard, or it can be a lethal, that is nothing but the fatality. So it is more dangerous or highest point as far as the hazard is concerned, that is 4 number, and 0 is lowest point. So in between 0 to 4 there are different categories, like this is can cause significant irritation for the health hazard, then can cause temporary incapacitation or residual injury for 2, and for 3 can cause serious or permanent injury likewise. So you can go through all these 0 to 4 meaning for different hazard. So why it is required? Because when we are studying about the safety data sheet or material safety data sheet, that data sheets as well as the different storage or handling containers are clearly mentioning about this NFPA symbol, and this diamond clearly indicates about the different aspects about the hazards and their severity. So we must know about this NFPA rating first. Then these are the documents which is required for the safety purpose for the different research laboratories, that is a chemical hygiene plan, an explosive safety plan, laboratory facility requirements, and PPE plan. So these are the major requirements as per as the safety documents concern, where these energetic materials are handled in the different laboratories. So what is chemical hygiene plan? So in this chemical hygiene plan, there are guidelines to handle, label or store hazardous laboratory chemicals based on the characteristics. So we must know about the characteristics of the different materials, properties, and their hazard should be known. And then from that characteristics, from that properties, we have to decide how to handle these chemicals, how to label these chemicals, and how to store these hazardous laboratory chemicals. Then identify and understand the chemical and physical hazards. So we must know about the physical properties of this material, chemical properties of these materials, and on the basis of this property, we can identify the physical hazard and chemical hazard of that substance, and then we can understand the different hazards with reference to the latest literature. The safety protocols to reduce the exposure, injury from the violent reactions. So where it is clearly mentioned that symbol capital V in the hazardous chemical symbols or HAZCHEM panel. If it is a V, that is capital V clearly indicates the violent reaction, then we must follow the safety protocols, safety rules and regulation to reduce the exposure, which is mentioning the violent reaction after this temperature, violent reaction after this exposure, etc. Then we required some specific PPEs for protecting from these energetic materials. So depending on the characteristics again, so some materials may be explosive, some materials may be flammable, some materials may be hazardous to our health, some materials may be hazardous to our skin, some materials may be the combination of flammable and explosive characteristics, etc. So depending on the properties of that material, we have to select an appropriate PPE. Then location and use of emergency equipment. So whatever the properties of that material is, depending on that material, depending on the threshold quantity of material, and depending on the hazards and the severity, we can decide the emergency equipment installation process. And with the help of these emergency equipment, we can handle in case of any emergencies happen in that location. Then the emergency procedures, that is fire and chemical spill and explosion. These are the main procedures or the chances of emergency situation. So there may be a fire, there may be a chemical spill, or there may be a explosion. So depending on that, we have to handle this emergency equipment, and that is why we must know about this emergency equipment, how to handle this, and that is why trainings are also necessary. Then consistent appropriate labeling. So we have already discussed about this labeling of the chemicals. So depending on the labeling, depending on the NFPA symbols, all the UN classification symbols, UN classification category, or some different standards which is used for purpose. So from this labeling itself, from the pictogram, from that number, we can understand that this type of chemical, this type of hazard is available or present in this location or in this area. So that type of labeling is required everywhere in that laboratory or in that area. Safely dispose of chemical waste. So after processing, after preparing the final product, so remaining material, which is called as chemical waste, should be disposed of in a safety way. So in some of the locations, some legal requirements are there, and in some of the locations, some of the good practices or the conventional practices are there. So depending on your location, depending on your state or country, we have to follow this safety disposal system of the chemical waste. We have to check the chemical compatibility as well. So in the previous session, we have already discussed what exactly the chemical compatibility is. So you have to check your material with the other materials, because in some of the research laboratories, at least 4 to 5 chemicals, that is energetic materials, are utilized for a particular product, and for that purpose you should first check the chemical compatibility of first material to other 4 materials, and likewise. Then only chemical hygiene is not sufficient for the safety aspect, and that is why some points should be followed, like strict explosive and personal limits. So whatever the explosive or energetic material which is used by that person, so for a single person also there should be some limit. So you have to handle this much gram, this much milligram, or this much kgs only for this area. Likewise, you have to decide the personal limits to handle these types of explosive. Then approved and signed standard operating procedures, that is SOPs, for all explosive operations. So whatever the materials you are going to handle in that laboratories, so each and every material should be followed by the SOPs, and all the SOPs should be followed by each and every employee in that location. Then training program for explosive laboratory personnel. So how to handle this, how to store this, what precautions should be followed by that person, each and every thing should be contained in the training program. So the employee should be first trained for the storing, for the processing, for the disposal of that chemical waste, etc., and then only he or she should allowed to handle all these types of materials. Then there is another system that is called as peer review systems. So if one person is handling these energetic materials, that other person should be present there, and he or she should observe the processing or the steps or the SOPs or the PPs, etc., for that person. And in a similar way, when the second person is going to handle these types of energetic material, then the previous one should observe first. So this peer review systems indirectly learn and teach you in a minimum time. So these practices should be followed, because normally when these energetic materials are handled, normally it is handled by the scientist level employees, and generally they think that when I'm alone, then only I can focus on my work. But that is a bad practice, because for the energetic material, for the explosive chemicals, no one insists you to work in alone in a laboratory. So for that purpose, some other person like attendant in a general industrial aspects, that is called as attendant. But in this case, the observer or the supervisor is nothing but a colleague of that laboratory itself. So that colleague from that laboratory who can easily observe, who can correct that person, or if in case of emergency, in case of any type of hazard, in case of any type of fire or leakage of the chemical, etc., is happen, then the other person can easily help you out and to reduce that exposure, to reduce that hazard, or to control that emergency situation, the second person can be useful. So for that system in the research laboratory, generally peer review system should be followed. Then energetic materials, facilities, explosive safety requirements, these are generally discussed in each and every laboratories, that whatever the facilities you need to handle these energetic material should be given to the employees in each and every department. So that requirement should be listed out first. Then these are some of the accidents or the incidents which are happen due to this handling or storing or processing of these energetic materials. So this is one of the incident, that is in 1998, NSWS IGDIV, that is Naval Surface Warfare Center. The main source for this accident is nothing but the EST, that is electrostatic discharge, and the root cause is SOP and facility needed update for the controlling EST. So for this incident or accident, the main thing is electrostatic discharge. So due to this EST, this ignition is happened and the incident is happened. And what is the root cause? SOP or the facility is not updated for controlling this EST. So from the second accident also, you can observe the energetic materials like nano aluminium, perfluoro, tetradiconic acid is one of the reason, and operator is deviated from the approved lab review form. So that is manual mistake. And in the third accident, that is in the 2010 TTU, nickel hydrazine perchlorate synthesis. So that is another energetic materials, and the effect is student lost three fingers, his hands and face were burned, and one of his eyes was injured after the chemical was working with the detonation. So again, here also the electrostatic discharge is one of the reasons. So from these accidents, the CSB, that is Chemical Safety and Hazard Investigation Board of Texas, gives us some of the conclusions that the physical hazard inherent in the research were not effectively assessed, planned or mitigated. So the physical hazards are not properly identified and not controlled in a well manner. That is one of the conclusion. Then the university lacked safety management accountability and oversight. So that is safety management accountability is another reason. Then strict explosive limits never followed. So we have already discussed about the personal level explosive limit should be followed. So that is not strictly followed. That is another reason. Then previous incidents with preventive lessons were not documented. So documentation is not done, not tracked and formally communicated. So whatever the documentation you have, whatever you have observed and tracked the record, that should be communicated to the superior one, because after the communication, superior may give you some of the corrective actions, and then you can follow that corrective action, and there may be some preventive actions too. So all these things are skipped due to these non-documentation processes. Then the funding agency with a control over the research did not prescribe any safety precaution provisions. Then OSHA standards and guidelines have been developed to promote these hazard evaluation methodologies in an industrial settings. Similar resources that address the unique cultural and dynamic nature of an academic laboratories setting have not been generated. So after that incident, some OSHA standards and guidelines are developed for controlling these types of incidents. So specifically here, from this accident, physical hazard is focused. Then chemicals, how to handle this chemical is focused by the OSHA standard, and then they have developed to control this physical and chemical hazard rather than the health hazard. Then Department of Transportation, that is from the US, explosive classification is in the following manner. We have already discussed about the explosive classes, but some of the explosive classification is from the legal requirement, like MSIS 1989. Some of the explosive classification is as per the chemical rules and regulation, and some of the explosive classification is in the general. But this explosive classification is from the explosive chemicals or the energetic material which can be used in the laboratory. So that is from the US DOT, that is Department of Transportation. The division 1.1 is mass explosion hazard, 1.2 is projection hazards, but not explosion, mass explosion hazard. Third is fire hazard, and either a minor blast hazard or a minor projection hazard or both, but not a mass explosion hazard. So from this point of view, you can understand this 1.1 is mass explosion hazard, is the highest or higher level hazards, that is division 1.1. Then it is projection hazard, then it is minor explosion hazard, then it is very insensitive explosives, then it is extremely insensitive articles, and likewise. So from 1.1 to 1.6, the severity of hazard is going to decrease from 1 to 6. So these are the different classification as far as DOT is concerned. Then these are the examples of these energetic materials, that is primary, secondary, and propellant. So primary explosive can be initiated by dropping, impacting, friction, or electrostatic discharge. Example is mercury fulminate, lead azide, lead stafnet. So these are the primary explosive examples, and which can be initiated by these actions like dropping, impact, or friction, or EST. Then secondary explosive, that is sensitive to heat, shock, impact, friction, electrostatic discharge. And examples of this: military high explosive, that is trinitrotoluene, that is TNT. Then RDX, that is research department explosive. Then HMX, that is high melting explosive. And this C4, normally it is explosive containing explosive chemical, then plastic binder, plasticizer, and marker or odorizing agent. Then propellant class, that is nitrocellulose, single base, nitrocellulose and nitroglycerin, double base, nitrocellulose, nitroglycerin, nitrogunarine, triple base, ammonium perchlorate, aluminium binder composites. So these are the different examples with the classification like primary explosive, secondary explosive, and propellant. So in this category, you can observe the initiation for the fire or explosive is common, that is called as ESD, that is electrostatic discharge, and that is why we have to focus on this ESD part. So the maximum allowable limit is one of the concern for the persons. Whatever the conclusion from that CSB from the accident, and one of the major concern is the maximum allowable limit for the person. So restrict the number of personnel and amount of the energetic material to the lowest possible minimum at all times. Dedicated laboratory with posted explosive limits. Never store excessive material. Minimum requirement for the operation present in the laboratory at the time of operation. So two-man rule, that is already discussed. It is normally called as peer review systems also. So in the peer review, at least two persons should be used for a particular purpose, which is nothing but a research laboratory work. So never work alone. That is one of the key or the solution for this accident. Then training is one of the aspects. So mandatory training for everyone working directly or coming in contact with the energetic material. Then established training programs for the certification purpose. So some programs may be for 1 day, some programs may be for 1 week, some programs may be for 1 month, and some programs, training programs, are a refresher course. Even after some years, you have to refresh your training. You have to refresh your SOPs. You have to refresh your knowledge. You have to update your knowledge as far as the chemicals are concerned. And in some of the cases, if your energetic material is newly added in your research laboratory or in that research area, then also the training is essential, because you may not know how to handle, how to store, how to process this new energetic material. Then also the training is required. The documentation of the training is again essential. How much, which employees are trained by that particular trainer, who is a trainer, who is a competent person, then how much time is involved for this training purpose, what are the outputs or the outcome of this training, what are the negative points or the suggestions or the corrections which is required in the training. So depending on the feedback, again the training can be modified or the prepared from the employee point of view. Must be qualified to understand the SOPs, update training, and reinforce good habits with the refreshers also. So some employees are experts in that area, so that expert person should also go through the refresher training programs. Then SOP is another element. So SOPs should be designed by the competent person, by the expert person, and the elements of these SOPs are materials, laboratory equipments, experimental procedures, detailed hazard analysis, safety requirements and risk mitigations, signature page signed by the managers and the certified operators. So SOPs should include all these components. So which type of material, what is the category of that material, what is the level of that explosion, what may be the hazard and the severity of the hazard, what are the physical hazard, what are the chemical hazard, what are the health hazard, etc. All things should be known to employ through these SOPs, because after knowing this background of that material, the employee can understand what is the severity in case of fire, in case of explosion. So all these elements should be added in the SOPs. Then written standard operating procedures, that is written SOPs, should be involved in this handling of the energetic materials. Then site diagram, then explosive and personal limits, hazardous chemical used, safety process equipment, documentation requirement, PPE requirement, housekeeping standards, use of fume hoods, etc. should be included in the SOP components. Then signed and approved by the responsible department parties and Office of the Environment Health and Safety, signed by the process supervisor, worker, signature along with the validation statement to have read and understood these SOPs. So why these signs are required? It means it is clearly indicate that all these SOPs with all these elements are known to you and you are the responsible person while handling, while processing these type of energetic materials. Then laboratory documentation is one of the aspects. Then documentation required before conducting the explosive operation. So before starting the actual operation, starting the actual handling of these chemicals, you have to start the documentation first, that whatever the details which is required of this chemical, that should be written in that particular form, in that particular format. Sometimes you have to use the laboratory notebook. Sometimes some are go for the lab review form, then process review form, SDS on file or MSDS, etc. So from the different countries, from the different state or region, different practices may be there, but the main intention is that you must know each and everything about that energetic material. Then only you have to handle that energetic material in a safer way. Detailed procedure in written detail, the reactions, chemical reagent required, step-by-step procedure, special equipment required. So all these things should be written in that notebook or in that format or in that form. Signed by the responsible manager or designee, copy on file in department office and at work site. So these two or three copies should be there, that carbon copy should be there, so that if the person is not knowing about what exactly you are going to work, so from that document itself they can understand what type of work is going on. Then peer review systems, we have already discussed about this peer review systems for the processes that should be adopted, for the operations that should be adopted, and each and every employee must learn from the others' experience. That is the main intention of this peer review systems. Then laboratory facilities should be given by the management, which is required, why it is required, what is the importance of these laboratory facilities, all should be convinced to the management by the expert person, because these are the generally explosive category chemicals, and that is why utmost care should be taken while handling these types of chemicals. So for that purpose, you should ask some of the facilities, especially when we are talking about the impact, then friction or the ignition source, electrostatic discharge, etc. Sometimes we have to use this placard like red or green at the door to indicate the explosive is present or not, or no explosive present. So if it is red, it means explosive is present in that location, in that area, in that lab. If it is green, then no explosive present. So sometimes instead of color coding, instead of red or green, sometimes directly this explosive present and no explosive present can be used, whatever it may be. But from that text, from that color coding, from that symbol, that should be indicated clearly to each and every employee that explosive is present or not. Then how, while storing and handling, what are the points to be considered? So in the laboratory energetic material storage, stored behind shielding, that is one of the points. Explosive proof refrigerator can be used. Limited amounts should be followed. So we have already discussed about the personal level limits. Then we have to also observe about the maximum or threshold quantity limits as per as the standards and that organization's higher authority is concerned. Then do not store excess. Store in velostat bags or containers, never glass with the screw top caps. So sometimes we have to use these velostat bags, especially designed by the chemicals from the polymer itself, to avoid the electrostatic charge or the static charge development. Because normally whatever the bags we are handling, which are developed the static charge while handling these types of chemicals, that may be a loading That may be unloading or that may be a storing process. So to avoid the static charges, we can go for the velostat packs. Then laboratory energetic material handling, conductive mats should be used to avoid again the static charge, or whatever the static charge is developed, that should be nullified first. So we can use these conductive mats where you are actually operating or processing or handling these energetic materials. Then conductive bench top. So sometimes we require only milligram or gram of that energetic materials, and we are using only bench top for that purpose. So conductive bench top or grounded steel top should be used again to avoid that effect of static charge. Then use wooden in place of metal spatulas. So again, this conductivity can be an issue when you are using this energetic material, and that is why non-conductive materials or the insulators like wood can be used, and that is why wooden spatulas are preferred instead of the metal spatulas, because generally we are using these metal spatulas in the chemistry labs. Then paper filters can be used, never sintered glass filters or Teflon sleeves on rotovap. Do not grind with the mortar and pestle, grind with the ball mill and other approved remote procedures. So all these things which are given in this paragraph are clearly indicate that we are trying to avoid the static charge, we are trying to avoid the connectivity, or we are trying to avoid the voltage generation in that particular process. So these are some of the storage and handling guidelines for the energetic materials. Then storage of explosive hazardous waste, that is another aspect. So after processing, we have already discussed that hazardous waste should be, or the chemical waste should be disposed of in a proper way, whatever the guidelines given by the state government or the legal agencies, like stored this EHW, that is explosive hazardous waste, behind a shield. Limit storage of EHW to no more than the 1 week and avoid overnight storage of EHW. So generally we have to avoid this explosive hazardous waste to stored in that area overnight. So we have to dispose of it quickly, or we have to transport it to a safer location. Then shielding requirement is necessary or mandatory condition. Determine the appropriate grounding policy and explosion proofing for unique electronic equipments. So nowadays the latest technological electronic equipments can be utilized to avoid the explosion. Now we already discussed that ESD is the main concern in this energetic material. That is why ESD hazard should be studied first, and then we can go for the controlling of ESDs. So to avoid the accumulation of this static charge on sensitive materials, some of the guidelines are: ensure all electrical equipment is grounded. So grounding is necessary. Then do not wear nylon or other synthetic fabrics that possess the tendency to build up static charge. So we already known that in the t-shirt itself, in the towel itself, in some of the clothes itself, some synthetic fabrics can be used, and that can be developed a static charge. So we have to avoid these types of fabrics which can generate the static charge. Keep concentration of solvents and dust in the air as low as possible. So we have to control this concentration, we have to control these lower explosive limits. So that may be in terms of solvents, that may be in terms of dust. Then store extremely static sensitive materials only in the grounded containers. So whatever the container, whatever the boxes, whatever the vessels, whatever you are using for handling or storing these types of sensitive materials, that should be grounded first. So perform work with static sensitive materials on conductive surfaces. keep the humidity in the atmosphere to the appropriate level for the material being handled. So humidity is one of the major factor which can adversely affect on the EST. So if the humidity is less, then the chances of static charge development is more. The voltage which is generated due to the static charge is more than the percentage humidity where it is higher percent, and that is why we have to maintain the optimum percentage humidity, that is nothing but the 40 to 60% humidity in that location, in that area. So if the humidity is less, the hazard is more. Then some of the safety precautions while handling these types of materials, especially focusing on the ESDs, are observe personal and explosive safety limits, that is already discussed. Then note of chemicals, explosives, propellant, oxidizers used or present in the laboratory. So oxidizers are nothing but which can generate the nascent oxygen, which is highly hazardous, highly reactive, and that is why we have to note down which type of oxidizers are used in that research area. Then reminder that energetic materials can be activated in the four way, like friction, electrostatic discharge, impact and heat. So we have to avoid these four things to avoid the explosion in that energetic material area. So we have to avoid this friction, we have to avoid this ESD, we have to avoid the impact, and we have to avoid the heat source. Requires appropriate protective safety clothing and equipment. So from this four point of view, we have to choose the appropriate clothing, appropriate material of construction for this clothing as well as for the equipment also. Then observer and visitor refrain from handling these types of materials when they are not certified on the SOPs. If the visitors are there, then visitors should not allow for handling these types of material because they are not a certified trainer or certified employees which have already taken the training how to handle this type of energetic materials. So please avoid to allow the handling of these energetic materials to the visitors or the observers. Then identify hearing protections, gloves and respirator for the specific operation and necessary. Then working with the exposed solid ESD sensitive or uncharacterized energetic materials, wear conductive sole shoes or leg straps and stand on a conductive mat. So whatever the conductive materials is possible to use in that area, that should be used. So that may be a conductive mat, that may be a shoes, that may be a leg straps, or that may be the clothes or the materials which can nullify this static charge which is developed. Then identify exits and muster case of an emergency, question of clean in case of spill. This spillage of the energetic material and where emergency can be possible. So we have to identify the location as well as the muster points. Then general safety guidelines or the safety precautionary measures are: separate the experimental setup with proper shielding. So proper shielding is mandatory condition for all the types of materials. An additional safety screen in the fume hood. Cover the glassware with the adhesive films to reduce the fragmentation in case of explosions. In addition to lab coat, gloves, safety glasses, wear a face protection shield, ear protection, a leather jacket with arm protection. For hand protection, use leather gloves, that is welding type, ideally in combination with the steel interwoven Kevlar gloves. So this Kevlar is a good, that is versatile material which can be used for different purposes. Start the first experiments on a small scale of only a few milligrams and increase the scale gradually. Then in the grams, then that may be in terms of kgs. Some of the senior scientists use the materials in terms of tons also. Keep solid materials wet or soaked with the solvent as long as possible. Try to obtain solid products of small particle size. Smaller particle size are less sensitive to the mechanical stress. Then do not use the metal. Use spatulas made of wood, which is already discussed. Then keep sufficient distance between the materials and your body to avoid the static charge development, or which can be a source of ignition. Then wear ESD protective clothing, anti-static shoes, etc. So all these things are the safety precautionary measures while handling the energy type materials. So normally anti-static tools should be used, anti-static soles or the anti-static shoes should be used, conductive mat should be used, then conductive top, that is table top, should be used, and some material should be provided for while handling these types of energetic materials. So what are the compliance and the enforcement for this ESD or the energetic materials? So regular groups inspection conducted by the responsible parties to identify the deficiencies and record findings. So this team may be internal inspection team, which are the competent or the expert person in that area, or the team may be the external team or the third party who are the experts in that area. So that may be involved the supervisor, team leader, worker, and OEHS representative. So depending on your quantity of using, depending on the hazards and the severity of that particular material, we can group these persons and we can plan the inspection schedule. So corrective action plans are submitted within a given time frame to address the finding. So this CA action is important. So whatever the observation, whatever the points which is mentioned by that inspector and the time given, within that time frame only these corrective actions should be executed or implemented first. Then enforcement may be needed to correct the negligence. So within this time frame or whatever the points or the steps which is given by that inspector or the expert person, if it is not followed, then enforcement may be needed. Then these elements are related to the hazardous waste. So following practice should be adopted for this hazardous waste. Energetic materials like propellant, explosive initiators, rags and solvents contaminated with these energetic materials. Do not store these explosive contaminated liquids in screw cap containers. Explosive solid waste stored in the conductive velostat bags. So all these should be discarded in a proper way. Then for the successful ESD program, we have to follow all the guidelines which is discussed in the previous slide. Then and then only this ESD program can be successful. So the implementation, planning of that program, review of that program, corrections in that program, then the continual improvement in that program is the main key for the successful ESD program. Then these are the general ESD control practices. We have already discussed many of these, like grounding. So grounding of container, grounding of vessels, etc. are essential. Then wearing foot straps and testing them before entering the protected area. So testing and calibration is also important, because after the calibration, after the testing only, these foot straps can be utilized. Then conductive flooring should be tested, should be calibrated time to time. Then ESD policy should be defined and designed by the expert persons and representative from the different departments. So mobile carts have conductive wheels and drag chains, conductive chairs. Unneeded items are not brought into the ESD protected area. Everyone who enters the area must abide by the rules for the protection to the effective. Do not enter these areas without proper understanding of the ESG control procedures implemented in the area. So if you are visitor, if you are new person in that area, then you must first know about the ESD, what exactly the ESD is, how to control this ESD, what are the SOPs, and how to follow that ESD procedures. Then and then only you can enter in that area. Then conductive flooring is one of the good practice, dissipative work surfaces, personal grounding, grounded work benches, conductive carts with drag chains, conductive chairs, etc. are the major elements to control the electrostatic discharge. So these are the some of the examples of ESD policies and the symbols which can be used for attracting that attention, that is static safeguarded work area. So we have to follow all these norms which is given in the ESD policies. So all persons shall wear the smocks in the lab area, then black or yellow line is a limit of access without smock, etc. are the policy points. So likewise, you have to design your own policy for your research area for your company. And how to control and eliminate these effects of ESD. So we know what exactly the ESD is. Then we have already discussed what are the safety precautionary measures to control these ESDs are, and then what are the effects of this ESD now. So remove unneeded static objects from your workstation. Keep objects you need a safe distance away from the sensitive components and assembly. That is one of the concern, that is isolation process. And unneeded static objects should be removed from that workstation. Then use a topical anti-stat if possible to eliminate that static built up on the objects that are necessary to do your job. So wherever there is a movement, wherever there is vibrations, wherever there is a magnetic field, where there is an electric charge, then there is a chances of static charge. So we have to avoid these types of activities, these types of objects from that area. Minimize movement and frictions to avoid the static charge again. Protect sensitive parts from the charges around them. Use ESD protective packaging. Then place components and assemblies only on a dissipative mat or dissipative work surfaces. All personal surfaces and equipment must be grounded to drain off any charges that are created. Keep work surfaces clean and free of dirt built up. So we can avoid these ESD effects from these guidelines. Before you enter any ESD protected area, you must put on special footwear. So we already discussed about these safety shoes with anti-static charge or anti-static soles. So that should be used. You must test the footwear before you begin the work, before actually starting the work, because this testing and calibration is again essential step before using. And footwear must be tested twice per day, and don't wear shoe grounders and all ground hazards that are over 250 holes. So these safety shoes or the anti-static soles or shoes are utilized where only less than 250 holes are used. So that is nothing but the general voltage requirement for the residential area. So in the residence, we are normally using 210 to 240 volt. The best prevention program is a combined effort aimed at the prevention and the controlled elimination of the static charges through the practice of proper behavior, procedures, workstation design, layout, environmental controls, tooling, and component handling. Clothing is also one of the requirement to control this ESD, that is non-static generating clothing shall be worn in ESD protected areas, or static dissipative smocks shall be worn, and an outer garment, finger cords and glows when worn in an ESD protected area shall be made of static dissipate, lint free, particle free materials. So depending on the area, depending on the material, depending on the characteristics, depending on the process, procedure and the quantity of material, we have to choose the appropriate clothing. Then we have already discussed about this humidification. If the less humidity is there, then the voltage is more, means more hazard is there. Then the markings should be there, that is identification marking. So equipments and assemblies shall be identified so as to warn personnel before any ESD damaging procedure can be performed. So these are different symbols which can be used for the personal grounding systems, devices which is supplied to the all personnel working with or handy ESD items to prevent the accumulation of the dangerous ESD or the electrostatic charge levels. Then prohibition of these materials. So some materials should be prohibited, some tasks should be prohibited, like smoking, eating, drinking, etc. So unapproved tools or static generating materials and or materials unessential to the fabrication area are also prohibited at that workstation. Then workstation grounding and is an essential activity. Workstation identification should be there with the help of some signs, placards, symbols or some marking system should be there, like the attention, like caution, static control area, or attention, you are now entering an ESD protected area, like that. So these are the different sources of ESD, that is work surface, waxed, painted or plastic surfaces. Then floors, waxed, common vinyl tiles, sealed concrete. Then clothes, common smocks, non-conductive shoes, synthetic material, especially nylon. Then chairs, vinyl, fiberglass, finished wood. Then packaging, common plastic bags, foam, trays, tote, boxes, etc. Assembly area, spray cleaners, heat guns, blowers, plastic tools like solder suckers, brushes, cathode ray tubes, that is CRT, etc. So these are the different example and different surfaces and the area where electrostatic charge can be developed. So we have to avoid these types of surfaces and these types of area. So this is the table which clearly shows you the relationship between the relative humidity and the voltage generation due to the static charge. So walking across a carpet, that is a general activity in any type of industry, any type of research area or any type of laboratory. So after walking across a carpet, if the relative humidity is 10 to 20% only, then near about 35,000 volt can be generated with due to this static charge. And if the relative humidity is controlled or maintained in between 65 to 90%, then the static charge can be developed only up to 1500 volt. Likewise, you can go for these activities like walking on a vinyl tile floor, that is 12,000 volt for this humidity and 250 volt for this humidity. Vinyl envelopes for work instruction, 7000 volt for this humidity and 600 volt for this humidity. Worker at bench, 6000 volt for this humidity and 100 volt for this humidity. So depending on the humidity also, this voltage can be generated, and it is dangerous when the relative humidity is less than the 20%. Then this is one of the example from these arrows. From this point you can observe that this safe work bench process and the facilities required for that bench while handling the energetic type of materials. So connectivity is also there. Then conductive mat is also there. Then conductive material at the rest is also there. Conductive pen is also there. Then some of the material which are used to nullify the static charge developed. So grounding is also necessary. That may be a personal grounding, that may be a common grounding. So all these facilities should be required while handling these types of energetic material on a bench on a daily basis. So these are the different testing requirement for this energetic material. So for work surface, we already focused these points. For work surface, for the test, parameters are greater than 1 into 10 raised to 6 ohms and less than 1 into 10 raised to 9 ohms. The frequency for the verification intervals is quarterly. So this is the ohm criteria, that is test parameters. This is the item that is testing is requirement for this work surface, and the frequency for this testing is quarterly. Likewise, for the protective floor resistance, that is less than 1 into 10 raised to 9 ohms, after cleaning the floor shall be checked. That is also quarterly requirement. Protective floor grounding, greater than 10 raised to 5 and less than 10 raised to 9 ohms from the floor surface to the equipment ground, quarterly requirement. Wrist strap, which is already shown in the previous slide. So this wrist strap that is having 10 raised to 6 ohms plus minus 20% of the user defined values. The frequency is on the daily basis. Then footwear grounding, that is twice in a day. That is why it is clearly mentioning that on the daily basis, and the test parameter is less than 35 into 10 raised to 6 ohms. So these are the different testing facilities should be adopted. And if in case if the state government or the central government or that in that region a particular standard can be adopted, that is stringent standards are there, then we must follow the stringent standards as per as these testing requirements for the energetic materials are there. So it is not the case that you should follow only the local standards. If the stringent norms, stringent standards are there, then we must follow that one. Thank you.